Hello from the Music Interview Corner. Today from Basel, Switzerland, from Balois Session with Milo. Hi, Milo.
Hello, how are you?
I'm fine, and you?
Great, really happy to be here.
Yes, and you were here before, right? In 2012, I think?
Yeah, I feel very privileged to be invited again. 4 years ago, I performed here, and it was still called Avo Session. Mm-hmm. Now it's Balois Session, but really happy to be here again. Feels like... Yeah, it's a nice feeling. I remember, you know, last time that I didn't really know what to expect, and it was I think I was more nervous. Now I feel good and relaxed, and I can't wait to show the audience and the festival what I've been doing since last time. You know, I will play many older songs as well, but I'm also going to play some songs that I didn't have last time. So I'm excited.
And are you getting kind of attached to Switzerland in a way?
My connection with Switzerland is a special one. I fell in love with Switzerland, let's say in 2009, when I started playing outside of Belgium for the first time, and Switzerland was one of the first places that embraced my music outside my own country. And yeah, it's been a great few years. I wish I could come here even, you know, more often, but I'm coming back for a concert in Lausanne as well in December, and I hope to do more cities maybe in the spring or in the summer next year.
Very cool. And I need to talk about that because I am very fascinated by California, and I've heard that you are very fascinated by California too.
Yeah, so my connection to California goes back to just after I finished high school. I went to live in San Diego in California for a year. I studied there, and I made a lot of friends, and I really fell in love with people and the weather and California in general. And so at the end of 2011, I had just played for nonstop for 3 or 4 years, and I was sort of at the end of a chapter, and also of the end of my energy. So I took an impulsive decision, and I just said, I rented an apartment in LA, and I just went, and I didn't know for how long I would stay, but I just felt I needed some time off. And the funny thing is that I wanted to take a break, but after a few weeks there, I started playing again and writing new music, and that ended up being the album Silver Linings. And now, today, I'm sort of still with one foot in Belgium and one foot in Los Angeles, and it's a great balance, because when I'm in Europe, I focus on the concerts, and this is where most of my audience, my fans are. But in LA, I always focus on recharging my batteries, and to actually start working on new music. So it's now the second, Modern Heart, the latest album, is the second album that I wrote and recorded there. So far it's working very well for me to combine both places.
Cool. And how did you experience the recording process?
It was really nice. It was a lot easier and more fun, I would say, than the one before. The one before, I was looking for what my next step would be. And I ended up not taking a step. I just ended up making one album, and very intimate acoustic album for myself that I wanted to make. And this one was sort of, before I started, I knew very well what I wanted to do, how it was going to sound, and who I wanted to make it with, and the kind of songs it would be. And so that made everything so much easier. The album before, I wasn't so sure. I was just sort of like, should I do this, or should I do this, or maybe this? And with this album, I knew exactly where I wanted to go. So it was a really fun album to make. And I actually, the cool thing is it opened up a new door for my music and my you know, the style of the way of working. And since I released that album, I haven't stopped writing music. So I'm actually, it just keeps coming. Ideas keep coming, songs keep coming. So I wouldn't even rule out that maybe I will release some brand new music, in the next few months or something. It's just a really fun period for me. And it's different because sometimes you make an album and at the end you're just empty, you know, and you don't write new songs for a very long time. But it was different, and it was really great to see how Howling at the Moon started, you know, exploding a little bit on Spotify and YouTube, and I got so much response, and I was really, it's really cool. It's not something you get used to. I've had it a few times in the past where songs really blew up, and it's not something you get used to. It was really great, and it's very rewarding after you put all the work in an album and in songs to get such great feedback.
That's really cool. I think LA opened something up in you.
I think so too. Yeah, absolutely. And it's still one of the best decisions I think that I took to do this. And again, I'm sure it can be another place too. It's not necessarily only about LA, but I think it's important to be able sometimes to only focus on being creative and trying to block out as much distraction that you can from the outside world. I think it's good.
And would you say that the music scene is different, or the way to produce music is different in the States than in Europe?
Hard to compare. There's incredible talent in Europe and in Belgium and in Germany and in Switzerland and France, and people are very, very good at what they do. LA is different in the sense that it's just the amount of talent that there is, the amount of studios, everything is so much bigger. It's really the music capital of the world, I think. But that also means that the challenge with LA is that you really have to find the right people for you, because you can make many different kind of albums. It's hard. That's the hardest thing. And I also, me too, there's an abundance of possibilities, and sometimes it makes it harder to decide. And so that's, for me, in the first few years, I was like trying to find my way to the right people. And now I have a much better sense, like, who I should work with for what. And the good thing is also by now I know how to record an album, how to write a song, and it makes everything easier, I would say.
And what I really love about your music videos is that your songs are very touching, but your music videos are kind of crazy and funny. For example, Howling at the Moon, you were an ice bear, basically. And now my favorite is No, 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 where you're interacting with this fluffy creature. How did you get that idea?
Well, you know, I tried to. For me, videos are very important. When I was younger, I even had a dream to become a director and to make movies. And then my focus shifted to music. But I still use, the concept of film and music videos as an extra, as a way to reveal extra layers about myself and about my songs, and this time I wanted the songs to connect. So there's, you know, the polar bear figure in Howling at the Moon, and this time for No, 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 we came up with a different kind of creature. You know, instead of the white sort of innocence, nice, gentle, now we sort of an evil counterpart. So it's basically, you know, sort of a symbol for the devil on your shoulder, who is like sometimes whispering and making you do or consider bad things. But it's all very lighthearted. I like it because the song is about, you know, realizing that the times that you made mistakes, or that people, you know, said no to you, that actually those things might have made you stronger and maybe even put you on an even better track. And so it's a positive message. But the video is a story told in reverse.
Yeah, and such a great idea. I love it.
Yeah, and I just always try to raise the bar a little bit. And I've made many videos now, so for me it's not enough to be like, oh, let's make a video. I'm sitting on a chair and that. Unless that's done really cool, it could work, I guess. But I just always I'm looking for something else. And I just was introduced to this really talented director.
He's named Jonathan, like you, right?
Yeah. So that's always a good sign. His name is Jonathan Agustavo, and he's 30. And 4 years ago, he directed the three big videos for Macklemore and Ryan Lewis, Thrift Shop and Can't Hold Us and Same Love. And he has made very many videos, before I always worked with young Belgian directors, and now I kind of felt like, you know what, let's try it. There was a clear connection between us, and we went back and forth about a cool concept, and then we made this video, and it was so much fun to make. And I have to say, like, I don't only make videos to promote a song. I also make videos because I love making it. I love that this is things I can create, and it's cool to see people trying to figure out what it means, and everybody's sending me their own interpretation, and I think that's great, so I'm really proud of it.
I was wondering, I thought first in the video the creature was female, because the song is about an encounter with somebody female. Why is the creature called Tom?
Well, the Tom, that actually is just, so when Jonathan Agustavo, the director, and me were emailing back and forth, it just became this creature. And for to him right away, you know, he said, you know, It's called Tom. But that's, and we just kept it in there, and it's a little confusing because it says in the credits, but I kind of like that it's confusing, and it's also just kind of funny because my good friend Tom, who's the guitar player since 2007, the two of us sometimes end up like late night, and we have a crazy night. But that's pure coincidence because the director didn't know that Tom. So I kind of like these layers. Just like at the end of the video, it's the beginning of the story. There's a laundromat, and Howling at the Moon is playing, and you see a washing machine.
I noticed that's such like Tarantino style.
And it's also for me because you know there was a furry creature that's all white in the first, and now there's a sort of the opposite, and it seems almost like he came out of the washing machine and something went wrong, you know, and it's because all of a sudden he has this evil, because when I posted pictures of the before the video, they were like, oh, it's so cute, oh, it's nice, he looks so nice. He's not so nice as he looks, like he's evil. I mean, he beats me up, so he's actually a pretty bad guy, but it's fun to make, and thank you for watching. I would say this is probably a very confusing conversation if you haven't seen the video.
So yeah, watch it immediately.
Otherwise, none of this probably makes sense.
At the 9th of November, you start your international tour in New York, and then you go to Canada, the Netherlands, and Czech Republic, and Germany, and everywhere. How do you feel about it?
Well, really great, because I actually haven't, you know, the album came out right before the summer. I played some shows, and I was busy doing promotion and everything, but actually haven't performed that many times, you know, presenting the album in clubs. So I'm really looking forward to first starting in New York and then Montreal, Quebec and Toronto. And then, yeah, there's a sort of a first leg for Europe. It's only one in Switzerland, Lausanne, two in Germany, I think, two in Austria, two in Belgium. So it's just a little bit. But if all goes well, and I have a pretty good feeling about it, then we will announce more dates for next spring, and then we continue touring and presenting sort of the new sound.
Thank you very much for the interview.
Thank you.
And all the best for your tour.
Thank you.
And goodbye from the Music Interview Corner.
Bye.